Good morning, St. John's.
Good morning.
It is a joy to see you on this absolutely beautiful Sunday morning. What a joy to drive over to church today. It's so good to be here. But I have a question for you. How are you today?
Blessed be the Lord.
Oh, very good, very good. Well, we're going to follow a service today that focuses on the hope that is ours, the hope that is much more than anything this world has to offer, the hope, the guarantee that the best is yet to come. This is the day the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. This could be the day. Are you ready? Let's join in our own.
Deserve your present and eternal punishment. For the sake of your
Almighty God, in his mercy, has given his only Son, Jesus Christ, to die for you. For his sake, forgives all your sins. As a called and ordained servant of Christ and by his authority, I forgive you all your sins in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
In peace, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For the peace from above and for our salvation, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For the peace of the whole world, for the well-being of the Church of God, and for the unity of all, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For this holy house, and for all who offer here their worship and praise, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
Help, save, comfort, and defend us, gracious Lord.
Amen.
Praying, and in a trance I saw a vision, and I saw something like a large sheep being let down from heaven by its four corners, and came down where I was. I looked into it and saw four-footed animals of the earth, wild beasts, reptiles, and birds. Then I heard a voice telling me, "Get up, Peter, kill and eat." I replied, "Surely not, Lord. Nothing impure or unclean has ever entered my mouth." A voice spoke from heaven a second time, "Do not call anything impure that God has made clean." This happened three times. Then it was pulled up to heaven again. Right then, three men who had been sent to me from Caesarea stopped at the house where I was staying. The Spirit told me to have no hesitation about going with them. These six brothers also went with me, and we entered the man's house. He told us how he had seen an angel appear in his house and say, "Send to Joppa to Simon, who is called Peter. He will bring you a message through which you and all your household will be saved." As I began to speak, the Holy Spirit came on them, as he had come on us at the beginning. They remembered what the Lord had said, "John baptized with water, but you will be baptized with the Holy Spirit." So if God gave them the same gift he gave us who believed in the Lord Jesus Christ, who was I to think that I could stand in God's way? When they heard this, they had no further objections and praised God, saying, "So then even the Gentiles, two Gentiles, God has granted repentance that leads to life." This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
We should add our praises too, because we would be among the Gentiles. The second letter, or the second reading, comes from Revelation chapter 21. As a basis for the sermon this morning, a new hope that is ours in Jesus. "And I saw a new heaven and a new earth. The first heaven and the first earth had passed away, and there was no longer any sea. I saw the holy city, the new Jerusalem, coming down from God, prepared as a bride, beautifully dressed for her husband. And heard a loud voice from the throne saying, 'Look, God's dwelling place is now among the people, and he will dwell with them. They will be his people. God himself will be with them and be their God. He will wipe out every tear from their eyes. There will be no more death or mourning or crying or pain, for the old order of things has all passed away.' He was seated on the throne and said, 'I'm making everything new.' And he said, 'Write this down, for these words are trustworthy and true.' He said to me, 'It is done. I am the Alpha and the Omega, beginning and the end. To the thirsty, I will give water without cost from the spring of the water of life. Those who are victorious will inherit all this, and I will be their God, and they will be my children.' This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Please stand. Has come, when her baby is born. born, she forgets the anguish because of her joy that a child was born into the world. So with you, now is your time of grief. But I will see you again, and you will rejoice, and no one will take away your joy. This is the gospel of the Lord. Excuse me. Christ is risen.
He is risen indeed. Hallelujah.
Please be seated. It is time for the children's message. Do we have any of you want to come up here? Anybody courageous enough to come up here with this strange old pastor? Oh, I don't look like a grandpa. Okay, but I am. Well, I always like to share this, and I know I've done it before here many times. But as we think about the hope that is ours in Jesus, the guarantee of heaven, the only thing we have to remember, see if you remember this, is to always, 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 always. I heard that. Stay close to your Jesus. Yeah. The most important thing is to stay close to Jesus, which is why church is all about. Staying close to Jesus, rehearsing our faith, and also having that chance every week to come before God. Confess up and admit our sins. Hear the good news that our sins are all forgiven. What I love about St. John's is Christ above the altar. The victorious Christ, the risen Christ. His hands like this with the nail marks in his hands and his feet. To remind us that Jesus has done it all for us. So we want to stay close to him. How's that going again? Always, 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 always
stay close to Jesus.
Each of us do that. Join now in our service.
Thank you.
Gracious Heavenly Father, we thank you for once again gathering us in your house. We are keeping your promise to feed us with your word, to bless our fellowship. Today, remind us of the hope that is ours, the confidence, the assurance of eternal life that is ours in Jesus and Jesus alone. In his precious name. Amen. Lord God, our focus is our reading from Revelation 21, where in verse 5 we find this. He was seated on the throne and said, "Behold, I'm making all things new." Also he said, "Write this down, for these things are trustworthy and true." Please be seated. Grace, mercy, and peace to you from God our Father, from our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Amen. As I said at the beginning, it is truly a joy to be with you today and to share this message, because we all need hope. We live in a world that seems hopeless. There's so much going on that has things upside down in the world, in our country, even in our church. It's our church body. It's crazy what's going on. But God is there. And I know you're wondering what's going to happen at St. John's, because I know Pastor Schneider wants to finally retire. But if you have a meeting today to talk about that, I look forward to being with you for that. God will lead you, just as he leads all of us through everything in this life, because he has a plan. But the ultimate thing is to remember where we're going. The best is yet to come. And that is true. A lot of people don't have that hope. They're pessimistic. They're negative. They think it's up to them, and then they do all sorts of crazy things. In our text today, the Lord tells us, yep, there'll be sorrow in this life. We have hope. We have a promise that our sorrow will be turned to joy. In our version, it says, your grief will be turned to joy. And it gives that beautiful comparison of a woman giving birth to a baby, and as I understand from not doing it myself, right there, it's not a pleasant thing at all. I got in trouble when our daughter was born. After my wife had the joy of holding our little girl, and we're taking her back to her room, I said, "Let's have another one." I went quickly enough to get that. But the picture here is the sorrow of this life compared to the childbirth pains and the joy that comes when the baby is born. The joy that is waiting for us. That's my prayer for each of us today, that we will take time to focus on what is in store for us. What we mean when we say the best is yet to come. He was seated on the throne, our text says. It says, "Behold, I'm making all things new." That's true for him. I like the story of a young man who was visiting with the pastor after his father had died. The pastor brought out the record book of baptism, showed his father's name, the date, the sponsors, talked a little bit about baptism. On that day, God gave his father a promise. He said, "I will be your God, and you will be my child, and I will walk with you every day of your life right up to your best day." And guess what? That wasn't just a promise for that man's father. That's our promise too. Walking with us every day, right up to our best day. So, since he guarantees that, why do we worry? Why do we fret? Oh, I know why. We have a pulse. We're human. It's part of our nature. But then that pastor went on and said, "Here's your dad's confirmation letter." There was the date, there was the sponsors, and his verse, which was in Genesis 15. It was in German, but they read it in English. "Do not be afraid. I'm your shield, your very great reward." What words to follow that man throughout his life? What words for you too? How does it go? "A mighty fortress is our God, a trusty shield and weapon. Protect us during our days on this earth." Again, why do we sometimes act hopeless? Why do we get down? We have a guarantee that God is with us, defending us, leading us, and guiding us. That's the promise for all who have faith in Jesus. But how can we have this confidence? Because the names of the redeemed are not only written on a baptismal record or a confirmation record, but they're also written in the Lamb's Book of Life. I think I turned it on. Where do I press? Up there. I'm not going to get to move. Okay, here we go again. Technical things. Your name is written in the Lamb's Book of Life. Luke 10. Rejoice that your names are written in heaven, in that book. Just think of it. You have a reservation in heaven. God has made it for you. And that's the beautiful thing. He's done it all. That's the glorious thing about grace. It is all God's doing. How many sins can you erase on your own? That's right. Zero. Zero. None. But Jesus did it all. Luther was frequently comforted by his baptism. When you're down, when things are rough, you can go like this. Or go like this. Remember that the sign of the cross was made on your forehead and on your heart to mark you as one redeemed by Christ crucified on that day when God claimed you. Most of us as babies. The baptismal font. Anybody baptized at this font? There you go. Okay, that's exciting. That's special. God claimed you that day. It's important to remember our baptism and what it means. One of our old hymns, baptismal hymns, Dearest Jesus, We Are Here, has this phrase. Write the name we now have given, write it in the book of heaven. That's a prayer. That the little one's name will be written in the book of heaven. Many confirmations are going on this time of year. Our prayer is that those young ones would stay close to Jesus. They would not wander. And while we're talking about that, Lord, you know all the young ones confirmed here. Please, Lord, those who have wandered, pull back to you. We beg this in Jesus' saving name for the sake of their souls. Please, Lord. That's one of the biggest challenges of the church, isn't it? Biggest heartaches to see young ones wander. But we pray. And for those who haven't wandered in church, we just put our thumbs up and say, thank you, Lord. We praise God for that. Why? Because eternity hangs in the balance. And the gift of heaven hangs in the balance. Where there will be what? No more sin. Can you imagine what it would be like to not have sin? Every day, in our thoughts, words, actions, we blow it. There will be no sin in heaven, no effects of sin, no illness, no allergies, no intestinal problems, no heart problems, no arthritis, no, none of those things. We won't have to wear glasses, and I won't have an excuse when I can't hear Barb. All gone. You will wipe every tear from their eyes. Just think of it. No sadness at all. The former things have all passed away. And then he gives us another picture, a beautiful picture of what heaven is like. I saw Jesus prepared as the church prepared as a bride adorned for her husband. What a marvelous picture again. How many of you like going to weddings? They're all special times. They can be very special. We pray that they are. And here comes the bride all dressed in white. That beautiful, beautiful picture. But this is a picture of the church. We are the bride of Christ who has done it all for us. We've been purified by his blood, as Paul tells us. Christ loved the church and gave himself up for her. There's that feminine pronoun again. He might sanctify her, make her holy, having cleansed her by the washing of water and the word. Mine's the baptism of God's word. So he might present the church to himself in splendor, spot, or wrinkle, or any such thing. That she might be holy and without blemish. That's the promise for God's people. So we rejoice. We rejoice that this hope that we have is not like we hope the Brewers win today, or we hope that the Bucks will win this series. That's earthly stuff. It's something that's guaranteed. I love the confident words that we read in our text. I am making all things new. Doesn't look right. old. No. Okay, that's fine. I make all things new. And it says, these words are trustworthy and true. Have you ever been disappointed by someone not keeping their word? Have you ever had a problem buying an appliance and say it's guaranteed and then it turns out not to be, or whatever it might be? We can break our word, but God will not break his word. The promises we're hearing here, the promises of heaven for all and any who repent and believe, are guaranteed. For all who stay close to Jesus and trust in him. What a wonderful thing. And then he uses these two words, three words. It is done. He's the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end. It is all taken care of. Like he said on the cross, it is finished. On the cross of Christ, he paid every single pay for every single sin that you keep you and me out of heaven. Once and for all, totally. I love the translation of it is finished. It's tetelestai in Greek. It literally means paid in full. He has stamped over your life in rich red blood, paid in full. Redeemed, sanctified, child of God. Rejoice, because his blessings are true. Blessings we celebrate now. Every time we come to church, we're celebrating the fact that we are children of God who have this glorious guarantee of heaven. Until then, we have a purpose, we have a plan, but this guarantee is ours. One that we want to share with others. In the gospel lesson, Peter is taught that the gospel is for all people, even the non-Jews. Did you get what that picture was all about? Here comes this food they had not eaten at all. Never touched his mouth. Unclean food. And God says, how can you say it's unclean when I can say it's clean? So the picture is clear. Go and share the message. Then he had the folks come to him who were not Jewish people. The message is clear because God desires that all people be saved and come to the knowledge of the truth. The world doesn't like it when you Christians say there's only one way to eternal life. There's only one way to be made right with God. And it's through Christ and his death and resurrection. But the Bible says so. So that's what we proclaim. We do it in a loving way, not a condescending way. In a way that says, okay, you may not like the fact that it's the only way, but I want you to know that for me it gives me great peace and joy. You can have it too. Look at our Jesus. We point them to Christ and all that he has done for us again. In a loving way. Why? Go back to Revelation 20. If anyone's name was not found in the book of life, he was thrown into the lake of fire. If we care about people, we want to share Jesus. If we care about people. Our churches want to be life-saving stations, pointing people to the only hope, the only rock in which they can build their lives. He is the hope for the hopeless. And what is the hope? That the old becomes new. How many would like to have me right now wave my magic wand and you are in perfect health like you were when you were a teenager? Mark raised his hand. Okay. I'm not sure if you have that great hair. Good hair. You have that good stuff that you have right now. God does that. That is coming again. Just imagine, to wake up in heaven, take a deep breath, and find heavenly air. You feel invigorated from head to toe. That is your heritage. That is real. That is coming for you, because God says so. The old becomes new. Say the last two words with me. In Jesus. Only in Jesus. I love the way the Lutheran Study Bible talks about this. In the Lord's new creation, we will completely forget the weeping and futility so characteristic of life in a fallen world. In their place shall be joy and gladness. Like we've never known, joy and gladness infinitely more awesome than when the Bucks won the ball last year, when the Brewers won the Super Bowl. Then when the Brewers win the World Series this year, Packers, whatever. Yeah. Far greater. Even the joy of a newborn baby. The joy will be awesome. Yeah. It is the Lord's desire that his repentant people, there's the key, that we remain faithful, pressing up, staying close to our Jesus and his precious, priceless, daily gift of forgiveness, that we should no longer remember or be troubled by our former sins. Our place in the Lord's new creation has been secured through faith in Jesus. There's that food again, faith that comes to us by grace, undeserved, given to us freely. Through the saving work of his hands, we have the joy of sins forgiven and the gladness of life eternal. Let that sink in. Maybe think about that this week. My sins are forgiven. Heaven is mine for sure. We Lutherans don't do this. That's almost enough to make us say, hallelujah. Oh, wait, we will. Christ is risen.
He is risen indeed. Hallelujah.
Guaranteeing that there is forgiveness in heaven for all and any who repent and believe. And what will heaven be like? Well, the great tragedy of the fall, the reason Adam and Eve hid, was they were afraid. They knew they had separated themselves from God by virtue of their sin. The look was coming. And I heard a loud voice from the throne saying, behold, the dwelling place of God is with man. He will dwell with them. They will be his people. God himself will be with them as their God. Reconciliation made right with God. Restoration to that perfect glory that was in Eden. It will be ours. How does the last stanza of Amazing Grace go? We've been there 10,000 years, bright shining as the sun. We've no less days to sing God's praise than when we first began. Wow. Look what's coming for us. And it's yours. It's yours. And it's also yours right now. You are not alone. Last Sunday was Good Shepherd Sunday. The Good Shepherd leads us and guides us through all the challenges of life, promising goodness and mercy throughout our lives, in his way, and then, what? How's the end? And I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. Wow. We have such wonderful assurance, all because of what Jesus did on the cross of Calvary. God was in Christ, reconciling the whole world to himself, not counting their trespasses against them, and entrusting to us the message of reconciliation. He does not count our sins against us like he should, like he has every right to do, but he loves us too much for us for that. That's again why he sent Jesus. And now we get to share that message of reconciliation with others. We have something to share with people. It's what we're looking forward to. Tell them, you can have this too. As we read again, and God will wipe away every tear from their eyes. And there will be no more death, just imagine, nor sorrow, nor crying. There will be no more pain, for the former things have passed away. It's very hard to imagine how wonderful is going, heaven is going to be. In fact, there's a beautiful song that talks about.
can only imagine.
This is is a trustworthy saying that deserves full acceptance. That is why we labor and strive.
Because we have put our hope in the living God, who is the Savior of all people, and especially of those who are Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name.
fill you with his joy. Lord, bless you and keep you. Lord's face shine upon you, be gracious to you. Lord, look upon you with favor, grant you his peace.
Amen. Hallelujah.
Now, let us depart in peace and serve the Lord.